Also, meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, mein Name ist Jasmin Schomann. Ich leite die Akademieprogramme hier in der W. Michael Blumenthal Akademie des Jüdischen Museums Berlin und begrüße Sie herzlich zu unserer heutigen Veranstaltung zum Thema Menschenrechte und Religionen, ein Widerspruch? Fragezeichen. Mit dem heutigen Abend eröffnen wir unsere nunmehr dritte dialogische Ringvorlesung. Und ich möchte mich an dieser Stelle herzlich bei der Allianz Kulturstiftung für ihre freundliche finanzielle Unterstützung bedanken, die uns die Realisierung dieser Reihe ermöglicht. Nach Vortragsreihen zu den Themen Judentum und Islam in der Diaspora sowie ethische Fragen zu in Judentum und Islam widmen wir uns in dieser dritten Reihe den jüdischen und islamischen Perspektiven auf die Menschenrechte. Damit ist die Ringvorlesung zu einem festen Bestandteil unseres jüdisch-islamischen Forums geworden. Mit dem Forum will die Akademie des Jüdischen Museums Berlin das Verhältnis von Judentum und Islam beleuchten und eine Plattform für die Auseinandersetzung mit religionsphilosophischen und religionspraktischen Fragen schaffen. Wichtig ist uns dabei, dass wir uns nicht nur an Fragestellungen abarbeiten, die von außen an Juden und Muslime herangetragen werden, sondern auch solche Fragen aufgreifen, die innerhalb der Religionsgemeinschaften heiß diskutiert werden. Und da zählen Menschenrechtsthemen wie Fragen der Religionskritik, des Religionswechsels oder einer geschlechtergerechten Lesart religiöser Quellen und Traditionen zweifelsohne dazu. Wir freuen uns sehr über Ihr reges Interesse und es ist uns eine außerordentliche Freude, dass wir für den heutigen Abend mit Rabbi Jill Jacobs und Professor Shaheen Sardar Ali zwei so hochkarätige Expertinnen zum Thema Menschenrechte zusammenbringen kommen. Auch Ihnen beiden ein herzliches Willkommen. Beide Referentinnen werden Ihnen gleich von Dr. Nahed Samour näher vorgestellt, die Sie als Moderatorin durch den heutigen Abend führen wird. Sie ist Rechts- und Islamwissenschaftlerin und arbeitet unter anderem zu einer islamischen Geschichte des Völkerrechts. Seit 2015 ist sie Junior Faculty an der Harvard Law School, Institute for Global Law and Policy und Postdoc Researcher am Lichtenberg-Kolleg, The Göttingen Institute for Advanced Studies. In ihrer Habilitation arbeitet sie zum Religionsverfassungsrecht. Und ich habe es schon gesagt, bevor wir jetzt gleich beginnen, also wer noch eine Übersetzung braucht, der greife sie jetzt schnell, denn jetzt geht es auf Englisch weiter und ich wünsche uns allen einen anregenden Abend.
Good evening, everyone. I'm delighted to be moderating tonight's opening talk on human rights and religion, a contradiction. And I'm delighted not only because we can anticipate tensions and dilemmas, as the title indicates, but because this topic and the entire succeeding series here at the Jewish Academy promise to reveal vast potential for translation work, overcoming perceived binaries of religion and law, national and international, the local concrete vis-a-vis the global and abstract, without sidestepping the challenges of any project of change and continuity. Surely one of the key concerns will be to address how Jewish and Muslim scholars have used the religious idea of a perfect past to try and change the imperfect present. How is the past being used to support a dynamic contemporary Jewish and Muslim discourse on rights? Allow me to very briefly ponder about why tonight's event is framed as human rights and religion as contradiction with a question mark. Do human rights imply equality? And do religions deny equality to whoever is not a member of the religion or a weaker member of the religion? Do human rights treat the other more favorably than religions do? And do human rights serve justice differently than religions do? While it has become part of secular, i.e. Protestant, approach to take a critical perspective on religion, it has surely not escaped your attention that human rights critique is also gaining prominence. This is in part because human rights, in their currently dominant form, highlight individual rights, like free speech and protest, which are very important rights. But these individual rights then marginalize collective rights, rights to water, the right to self-determination, rights as minorities or as indigenous. Human rights critique or human rights skepticism is increasingly voiced also because the human rights discourse is said to be overwhelmingly used to civilize and attack non-European peoples, aiming in part at reconstituting non-Western societies and peoples with a set of culturally biased norms and practices, leaving human rights violations of Western societies largely immune to accountability, like the human rights of refugees drowning in the sea. I'm mentioning these critiques just to allow for a bigger picture of human rights on a global level, and of course, to remind ourselves that human rights and religion always require us to bring in power relations. And it is within these power relations, legitimized by religion or else, that we need to think of the dark and the emancipatory sides of human rights, as well as the dark and emancipatory sides of religion. And now, what gets me most excited about tonight is that both speakers will talk to us from within their religious traditions, as well as with the experience of long, intense, and surely often painful human rights work, witnessing what humans can do to humans with or without reference to God. The first to guide us through these difficult questions is Rabbi Jill Jacobs. She is executive director of TRUA, the Rabbinic Call for Human Rights, which mobilizes a network of 1,800 rabbis and cantors in their communities to bring a rabbinic moral voice to human rights in North America and Israel-Palestine. She's the author of Where Justice Dwells, a hands-on guide to doing social justice in your Jewish community, and author of There Shall Be No Needy, Pursuing Social Justice Through Jewish Law and Tradition, both published by Jewish Lights. Widely regarded as a leading voice in Judaism and social justice, she regularly lectures at synagogues, Jewish community centers, and conferences, and has written about Jewish perspectives on social justice and human rights for more than 2,000 publications. Rabbi Jacobs has been named 3 times to the Forward's list of 50 influential American Jews, to Newsweek's list of the 50 most influential rabbis in America. And she holds rabbinic ordination and an MA in Talmud from the Jewish Theological Seminary, where she was a Wexner Fellow, and an MS in Urban Affairs from Hunter College, and a BA from Columbia University. She is also a graduate of the Mandel Institute Jerusalem Fellows Program. I'm very delighted and very excited that Rabbi Jacobs came all the way from New York to here. So please, Rabbi Jacobs, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much for having me here. It's really special to be here and especially to speak in about human rights in this place. Great, perfect. In speaking about Judaism and human rights, we start at the very, very beginning of the Torah with the first information that the Torah gives us about human beings. So if I can get the next slide, please. Or is this my clicker? Oh, great. All right. Looks good. Okay, so this is the first thing that we learn about human beings. So pretending that we're reading from the beginning of the Torah and we don't know anything yet about who we are and what the nature of human beings is. And God said, "Let us make humanity in our image and in our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." And God created humanity in God's own image. In the image of God, God created humanity, male and female, God created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that creeps upon the earth." It's a very, on the one hand, a very simple idea, that human beings are created in the image of God. And yet, that phrase, the image of God, has confounded generations of readers. What does it mean for humans to be created in the image of God? Now let's assume, along with dominant Jewish interpretations, that we're not talking about us being a physical representation of God, that we're not imagining that God has a nose and ears and a mouth, that we're talking about something a bit more metaphysical. So to answer this question, first we have to ask, well, what is it that we know about God at this point in the Torah? Because whatever we know about God should tell us something about what it means to be created in the image of God. So far, we know that God is a creator. God has created light, the sun and the moon, animals, the plants, etc. And we also know that God is the ultimate power in the universe, who presumably we would imagine commands respect and honor from everything and everyone that God has created. So from this little bit of information, the first thing that we can say is that human beings also deserve infinite respect and honor. So since human beings are created in the image of God, any injury to human beings is, by extension, an injury to God. So, oops, I didn't give you the rest before. Okay. So here's a note from Rabbi David Kimchi, who's often known as the Radak. He writes, "The human being is exalted over all of the lower creatures, so much that God created humanity in the divine image, with the intelligence that God gave humanity. For this reason, the other creations should be in awe of the human being, as should one person toward the other, such that a person will not destroy another's body or image." As this comment makes clear, creation in the image of God does not only grant us infinite dignity, it also confers responsibility on us. For the first time in the story of creation, God establishes a hierarchy in which human beings are granted dominion over all of the other creations. And not only that, we're also entrusted with care of the earth. Before now, there was no sense of hierarchy. There wasn't even a sense that there was any relationship between one part of creation and another. Each thing is created on its own. So the earth doesn't have responsibility for the sun, even though the earth was created after the sun. Animals don't have responsibility for the plants, etc. But as creations in the image of the Creator, we also have the power both to create other human beings, and we also have the power and the responsibility for taking care of other parts of creation. This is one of the places where we're explicitly told that human beings as creation in the image of God have the ability to create other images of God. When it describes the birth of Seth, of the third child of Adam and Eve, or there's different versions of the story, but let's say that it's a third child, it says that Seth is created in the image and the likeness of Adam. So the same language that's used to describe the creation of the human being is now used to describe the creation of every future human being, telling us that every single human being has the same status as a creation of the image of God as the first one. Now, when we talk about Judaism and human rights, one of the first objections that people often make is to say that Judaism doesn't actually speak in the language of rights. So there is language for rights in Judaism, but it's not the classic legal language that's used. Rather, Judaism usually speaks in the language of obligation, chiyuv, that we have certain legal obligations toward each other, toward God, toward the world. I would suggest that there's not actually a discrepancy between this language of obligation and the language of rights, but rather that rights and obligations are two sides of the same coin. We saw this already in the comment by Radak. Just go back for a second. Oops, there we go. That the fact of our creation in the image of God means that we have certain responsibilities toward other people. Primary among them is don't kill, don't destroy another image of God. So it's not just that we have certain rights and we wait and we hope that we are given those rights, but in fact, not only do we have rights and we can expect something from other people, but we also have obligations toward the other. It doesn't really do us any good to be created in the image of God if nobody has a responsibility to treat us as a creation in the image of God. And this is similar to how we talk about human rights in international law, that we speak both of the inherent rights of human beings and also of the obligations of countries to ensure these rights. So I'll just give you a little bit from one scholar of human rights. Oops, there it is. From Lewis Henkin, who writes, he's contrasting U.S. law to international human rights law. And he says, in the constitutional jurisprudence of the United States, individual rights have long been thought of as consisting only of immunities, as limitations on what government might do to the individual. Human rights, on the other hand, include not only these negative immunity claims, but also positive resource claims, claims to what society is deemed required to do for the individual. So in other words, it's not only that we have rights, but also countries have responsibilities toward the human beings whom they're responsible for. And in Jewish language, I would say that every single individual has a chiyuv, has an obligation toward every other individual. Jewish law doesn't speak in the language of states because such a thing didn't exist, but does speak in the language of individual right, of individual responsibility, as well as responsibilities of the community. And so Judaism translates the idea of Tzelem Elohim, of creation in the image of God, into specific laws through which individuals and society are obligated to protect the life and the dignity of every human being. The first of these laws, as I said, is do not kill. And the Torah makes explicit this connection between this commandment and our status as creations in the image of God. So the Torah tells us explicitly, whoever sheds human blood shall have his blood shed, for in the image of God, God created humanity. So the very first command that we get is don't kill another human being, another creation in the image of God. And the reason for this, as I'm showing you just one early rabbinic text, one midrash, in which we have Rabbi Akiva, one of the early rabbis, saying that anyone who sheds blood is regarded as though that person has impaired God's likeness. Okay, so killing another human being is not only destroying another image of God, that would be bad enough, but actually diminishing the divine image, which then is diminished forever. Now, I have to just mention that there's a glaring paradox in the law that the punishment for killing another human being is capital punishment. Because we're in a situation in which one person is dead, so the divine image is diminished by one. And so it doesn't necessarily make sense to now diminish the divine image by two. There's not an easy answer to this question, and I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about how Judaism deals with the question of capital punishment, which does exist in the Bible and in later law, at least theoretically. But part of the response comes in the way that the rabbis of the Talmud, so in the 5th and 6th and 7th century, deal with the idea of capital punishment. They are just as uncomfortable with this paradox as perhaps we as moderns are. And so what they do is they say, yes, there's capital punishment, but we are going to essentially legislate it out of existence. They put lots and lots of requirements on it. You have to have two eyewitnesses. They have to be looking from the same vantage point. So if you have one person looking out of one window and somebody else out of another window, it doesn't work. The witnesses can't be related to each other. They can't be related to either the perpetrator or the victim. They have to warn the perpetrator before the act takes place. Hey, do you know that if you actually go ahead and kill that person, that you will be punished with capital punishment? And the person has to say, yes, I know that. And then the murder happens. The witnesses are grilled on all sorts of things, including famously what the stalks of the fig trees look like. So you imagine a situation, you've just seen somebody kill someone else, and you get into the cross-examination, and the judge says to you, well, the stalks of the fig trees, were they brown or were they green? Right? I don't know, I was watching the murder. So they really make sure that there's absolutely no chance that somebody is lying. In U.S. law, I don't know about German law, but in U.S. law we speak about guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. This is guilt beyond any doubt, even any tiny, tiny shred of a doubt. Okay, so we've seen, as I said, that the Jewish approach to human rights begins with the assertion that every single human being is created in the image of God. And we've seen that that theology both endows us with the right to infinite dignity and also the responsibility to ensuring the dignity of others. And we've also seen that the destruction of an image of God irrevocably diminishes the divine presence in the world. But how is this concretized into law? I want to look just at one Talmudic text regarding the interrogation of witnesses that will bring to life a bit of what I said before about the difficulty of carrying out capital punishment. Okay. So this is from the Mishnah, so this is codified around 200 of the Common Era. And it asks, how are the witnesses intimidated in capital cases? So as I said, we have to intimidate them. We can't just bring them in. We want to really scare them, make sure they understand what they're doing. They would be brought in and intimidated in this way. Perhaps you're only repeating hearsay. Perhaps you're repeating what a trustworthy person said. Perhaps you don't know that we're going to check your testimony by inquiry and cross-examination. So the inquiry is the basic questions about what happened in the case, and the cross-examination, as I mentioned, is questions about what was going on in the world, what the trees looked like, other things to check that you were actually in that place where you said that you were. And then it goes on, you should know that capital cases are not like civil cases. In civil cases, the witness can make atonement through payment. So in general, there's an idea of false witnesses, that if people testify falsely and somebody is convicted on the basis of that false testimony, the false witnesses are then brought in and charged and can be punished with whatever the punishment is that they doled out to another person. So if you're talking about a civil case, if witnesses come and they say, this person stole $100 from this other person and somebody is convicted on that and they have to pay back the amount, or depending on the crime, maybe some amount times that amount, some greater amount. In the end, if the witnesses are proven to be false, they can make reparations through money. Now, they can't really fix somebody's reputation if we now think that someone's a thief, but at least they can pay back the money. But of course, if somebody has been killed, then even if the witnesses are now charged and convicted of a capital case, you can never bring back the person who's killed. So in capital cases, the witness is held responsible, it says, for the blood of the convicted and of this person's potential descendants through time. So it gets even harder. And then we have this example. It says, we find this in the case of Cain, who killed his brother. The Torah teaches that God said to Cain, the bloods, plural, of your brother cry unto me. It doesn't say the blood of your brothers. It says dameachicha in Hebrew, the bloods of your brother. That is, that Cain is held responsible not only for the blood of Abel, whom he's killed, but also the blood of all of Abel's potential descendants. It's a pretty serious weight to bear. So these witnesses who are about to testify to a capital case, which is most often murder, it could be some forms of idol worship or of incest, most often murder though, are now going to be held responsible for every generation until the end of time if they carry out this punishment. So they better be really, really sure. And then it goes on, and it says, this is a very, very famous text. If you've studied any Jewish text, you might have come across this line. For this reason was the human created alone, to teach that whoever destroys a single soul, Scripture holds guilty as though this person has destroyed an incomplete world. And whoever preserves a single soul, Scripture ascribes merit as though this person had preserved a complete world. And I want to just say there's a little asterisk there. I don't know if the note probably doesn't show up on the PowerPoint, but in printed editions of the Talmud, the word of Israel, meaning a Jew, is inserted there, but that is actually not in the original text. This is a universalist text, which we know both because it's not in the manuscripts, and we also know because it doesn't make sense in the context. In the context, we're talking about Cain and Abel, who are, of course, not Jewish. They weren't anything. They were just among the first human beings. OK, Okay, and then it goes on with this nice comment that the reason that God created human beings, that God created everybody from one human being, is for a few reasons. One is because if somebody is striking multiple coins from one mold, they're always going to look exactly the same, whereas God strikes multiple human beings from the same mold, and we're all unique. Equally creations in the image of God, and yet all unique. And it forces every single one of us to say that the world was created for my sake, because I am just as much a creation in the image of God as Adam, as the very first human being, as you, as any of you, as anybody else. Now, of course, the obvious question of the witnesses certainly is the witnesses saying, what do we need with all this tsuras, all this trouble? Why should I testify? And then it goes on and says, well, if you've seen something, as we say in New York, if you see something, say something. It's probably the quickest translation. If you've seen something, you have a responsibility to testify to it, because we don't want to have a world in which people feel like they can run around murdering other people without any consequences. So I want to say a few things about this text and how it concretizes the idea of Tzelem Elohim. First of all, the Jewish criminal justice system, as we see just in this little short text, is obsessed with trying to figure out how to create the most just system that protects both perpetrators or accused perpetrators and victims, alleged victims. So on the one hand, we want to make sure that the dignity of the alleged perpetrator is protected, that this person isn't convicted without a fair trial, that this person isn't convicted without a trial that eliminates any shred of doubt. And we also want to make sure that we are protecting people who are victims or potential victims by ensuring that there is a system of justice that will punish in some way people who have carried out a serious crime. In fact, one of the first laws that we get in the Torah, right after Noah and his family get out of the ark, there's a series of laws that they get, one of which is interpreted to mean that there's an obligation to create a system of courts, a system of justice. Something that I find remarkable about this text is I mentioned that this little bit is often quoted. It's very, very popular. It's often quoted without the surrounding context to say that every single human being is crucial, and that is incredibly important. And the context is crucial for me because it's important that this message about every single person being an entire world in and of themselves, about every single person being equally a creation in the image of God, comes in the context of a criminal trial, when we're talking about somebody who has potentially done the very worst thing that you can do, namely killed another human being. And what the rabbis are saying to us is, even that person who you look at and you say, I don't ever want to be near that person scares me, I don't want to be in a room alone with them, I want them to get the worst punishment ever. Even that person is equally a creation in the image of God, just like the person that they possibly murdered, just like every single one of us. And this is crucial because in any legal system, the real test of human rights comes with the question of whether we apply those human rights to the people with whom we find it most difficult to sympathize, whether that's the mass murderer, whether it's a child molester, whether it's a terrorist. But human rights, both in international law and in Judaism, are ours, every single one of ours, because we're human. In Jewish language, because we're created in the image of God. It's not because of anything that we did to deserve those rights. It's easy to advocate for the human rights of a child, of a friend, of somebody who's an upstanding member of our community. It's much harder to advocate for the human rights of someone who scares us or someone who's created who's done a terrible act. In my own organization, Trua, we organize around issues that include the rights of people who are incarcerated, including in the United States, including people who are in solitary confinement. And people often say to us, well, wait a second, aren't the people who are in solitary confinement the people who have done the worst crimes? That is sometimes true. It's actually not always true. More often, it's people who have violated some sort of prison rule. And our answer is, we're not saying that everybody who's in solitary confinement should be out of prison or that we want them as our neighbors or our best friends. What we're saying is that by virtue of being human, they have the same human rights that any of us have. So it's no accident that there are many texts in Judaism that speak of human rights, of the idea of Tzelem Elohim, of creation in the image of God, in the context of a criminal, of somebody who has done something terrible. I could have shown you many, many more texts that have to do with the dignity of the person who is being charged with a crime, that have to do with somebody who is, we might look at and say, well, that person is not like me, that person is poor, that person is begging, that person is somebody who I might not want in my community. That's exactly when Jewish law comes down and says, okay, that person has the exact same status as a creation in the image of God. So here's one comment by Rabbi Abraham Isaac Cook, who was late 19th, early 20th century, where he says, in the case of a corrupt person, it would be appropriate to hate that person as a result of his or her faults. But from the perspective of that person's Tzelem Elohim, the fact that they're created in the image of God, it's appropriate to treat this person with love and to know that the precious nature of this person's worth is more essential to him or her than the lower characteristics that have developed through his or her circumstances. In our world, very often we judge somebody by the worst moment in their life. If somebody has committed a terrible criminal act, they're forever judged by that criminal act. And what Rav Cook is asking us to do is to look at that person as a creation in the image of God. Now, that doesn't mean that they shouldn't be punished. Again, that doesn't mean that they should be allowed to roam the streets if they're dangerous. But it does say that whatever their punishment is, we continue to treat them with the dignity that they have by virtue of being a creation in the image of God. I just want to end with one last text, one of my favorites, that offers a challenging theology about the question of what it means to be created in the image of God. It says, Rabbi Meir used to say, this is a Tosefta, also early, maybe second century or so rabbinic text. Rabbi Meir used to say, what does it mean that one who is hanged is a curse against God? Okay, so the Torah teaches that one of the modes of capital punishment is hanging, or more likely, crucifixion. And again, all of the cautions that I said before apply and make it difficult or even impossible to actually carry out this punishment, but it exists in the Torah. And one of the things that the rabbis actually do when they talk about hanging or crucifixion, they say, well, you can't, it would be too much of a violation of somebody's dignity to leave somebody hanging in the public square, as might have been common. And so you basically hang them and take them down at the same time. So they say the person is already dead by the time you do this. It's a little gory. Again, probably never actually happened in real life, but it's probably theoretical. They talk about essentially putting somebody's arm up, and then while you're putting their other arm up, you're taking the first one down because you don't want to destroy their dignity by having them hanging in the public square. And so it says, well, why is that? Why don't you have somebody hanging in the public square, crucified in the public square? And it gives this parable of two twin brothers who are identical. One of them ruled over the entire world. So one of them is the greatest king of the world. And the other took to highway robbery, but they're identical. So after a while, the robber was caught, and they're crucifying him. So you imagine everybody walking by, seeing this person hanging in the public square. And everybody who's passing by says, the king is on the cross. And that's why it says, one who is hanged is a curse against God. So the text is theologically shocking, first of all, because of the suggestion that we and God are twins. God, obviously, in this the king, obviously, in this parable is God, and the twin brother is all of us, or perhaps the worst human being we can imagine, somebody who has done something so terrible that they are getting capital punishment. That person also is God's identical twin. So we're no longer just a reflection of God or an extension of God or God's the end of God's pinky toe or something like that. We are actually God's identical twin. We look exactly like God. You imagine the scene. People are walking through the town square. They see this person hanging, and they say, the king is dead. So then what happens? Do they run wild? Do they say, okay, no more laws. We can go out and break all of the laws. Do they feel so abandoned by the king that they're never, ever going to trust another leader? When the actual king emerges, we don't know where he is in this moment, but let's say he doesn't know all of this is happening. He eventually emerges. He might find out that in the interim, he's lost some power in the time that his subjects have assumed him to be dead. So similarly, what's called the nimshal, or the explanation of the parable, the text would say to us that if a person is hanged, if a life is taken, presumably after a fair trial where the witnesses are grilled, as I said, still, that is a curse against God. Because anybody who sees a convicted criminal, even the person who has done the worst thing that we can imagine, anybody who sees this convicted criminal treated in such a degrading way might reasonably conclude that God is dead, that how could there be God in a world in which human beings would treat each other in this way? Because it's only in a society that is forgotten that human beings are created, B'Tselem Elohim, that we would fail this ultimate test of human rights, that is to treat even the person with whom we have the most trouble identifying as somebody who was created, B'Tselem Elohim, in the image of God, as somebody for whom the entire world was created. Thank you.
Rabbi Jill Jacobs, thank you so much for taking us on a journey to a closed reading of religious text. And I think you've posed so many questions of what it means for a society and for a religious community to fail or pass the test of human rights. And this will surely resonate with us for the rest of the evening. Let us continue our conversation by bringing Professor Shaheen Ali on board. Professor Shaheen Ali is a professor of law at the School of Law at the University of Warwick, United Kingdom. She has studied law at the universities of Peshawar, Pakistan, and Hull, UK. She's a very prolific writer in the fields of Islamic law, human rights, women, and child rights. She was formerly professor of law at the University of Peshawar, Pakistan, for 25 years, and director of the Women's Studies Center at the same university. And she has served on the National Commission of Inquiry on Women, as well as the Prime Minister's Consultative Committee on Women in Pakistan. She also served as the first woman cabinet minister for health, population welfare, and women's development in the government of the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province in Pakistan, and the first chair of the National Commission on the Status of Women in Pakistan. She has consulted with a range of national and international organizations, including the British Council, DFID, UNICEF, UNIFEM, UNDP, to just name a few, and has provided legal expertise to US and UK courts in the area of Islamic law. She is a joint co-editor of the Journal of Islamic State Practice in International Law and member of the advisory board of the Journal of Gender Studies. So much for her scholarship and her practice. And on top of it, from 2008 to 2014, she was member and vice chair of the UN Working Group on Arbitrary Detention. So you're getting only an idea of the multiple facets of human rights that Professor Ali has worked on so far. Amongst the many distinctions she too earned, distinctions and awards, I just would like to mention that she was included amongst the 100 most influential women of Pakistan, and the Star Woman Award of the year 1996 was awarded to her. So this is the night of strong women, I think. So please join me in welcoming Professor Ali.
Good evening, everyone. And thank you very much for this kind invitation and for giving me the opportunity to express my views and share some reflections and thoughts with you. I couldn't agree more with what our colleague, Rabbi Jill Jacobs, was saying. And as she had put those slides up and was reading, in many places I could have shut my eyes and thought I was reading the Quran. And it's just so interesting. And before the meeting, I was saying to Rabbi Jacobs how my ignorance on Jewish law and Jewish tradition was very embarrassing. But as she was talking, I thought, no, I think I know a little bit of this. But I know this from the Quranic tradition, from the Muslim tradition that I was born and raised with. So really, it's almost such a shame that the world seems to want to focus on divergences and incompatibilities rather than on convergences and commonalities of the human traditions and of religious traditions. So I guess a few general remarks that I wanted to make to our colleagues this evening was, when I looked at the whole year's focus of the forum, I realized that a 30-minute conversation this evening was really not going to be able to go into any great depth on human rights in the Islamic legal traditions. And that therefore, in order to probably set the scene as well for the coming year's forums, that I would pick up some of what I would call the thorny issues. So give you those areas, because I mean, I'm a country bumpkin from the mountains of Northwest Pakistan. So I'm kind of touchy-feely. I've been there, I've done it, I've got my hands dirty. So we know the general sort of positive aspects of human rights across religious traditions. But I think where we kind of feel uncomfortable with is what I would call the thorny issues that really impact on our lives and on our communities, both at home and abroad. And so this is where I will try and use some examples. And they'll be brief examples, but by all means, please ask me questions after they're done. And some of the areas I would like to look at is gender issues, so gender equality, freedom of religion, slavery, and so on and so forth. So those are the kind of issues that I would like to be challenged on and that I would like to challenge myself on. Now, the second point I wanted to make here is I've started feeling less helpfulness of these comparative discourses on human rights where one puts international human rights law on a pedestal as the perfect scenario. And then, so this superior location, and then try and bring religious traditions and say, now, come on, try and compete with them. And so all the time, you've got to stand there and adopt positions of either being apologetic for the religion or trying to distance yourself from it or trying to develop some arguments about it. Now, for me, let's be very clear. The word human rights, as you and I understand it today, didn't exist in the Torah, in the Injil, I mean, the Bible, in the Quran, so many centuries ago. The term in its modern 20th century onwards articulation. Now, having made that general statement, I would say that does not mean that the concept of human rights was absent from these traditions. See, this is very different. But what some scholars and activists and people would like us to do is to say, compare a 20th century, 21st century tradition with a 7th century tradition in the case of Islam, and even much older in the case of Judaism and Christianity. Now, that is not fair. And as Rabbi Jacobs showed and demonstrated very ably, we have what you would call equivalence, comparable doctrines. Why? Because human beings, simply by virtue of being human, have got human rights. So human rights, there's no question that there isn't any human rights in any tradition. However, context and situation is what was important for us to imagine. The third point I'd like to make is that the concept of human rights in the modern day scenario of post-1945 United Nations is broadly speaking been given and presented and written in what I would call the Western languages. So it's English, it's French, could go as far as Spanish, I suppose, and German. But that's where it stops. And then non-Western languages and cultures and traditions have to dig around for translations that actually fit those words. And often they don't. So for me, human rights in the Islamic traditions have often got lost in translation. Because one of the most used words in the Quran and in the Islamic legal tradition is haq. And haq is translated as rights. There is no other translation in any of the Western languages except the word rights. But haq is more than rights. Haq is justice. Haq is social justice and equality and giving people their entitlements. But the word rights in the English language is very formal, is very restricted. So there some misunderstandings start emerging. However, there is the issue of time and context. And I think this is where the modern day conversation and the lines of contestation are drawn. Now, insofar as Islamic law is concerned, the sources of Islamic law point to the reasons why there is so much of plurality across the tradition and why there is so much contestation and almost contradiction in terms within the text on which we base human rights in Islam. So the Quran, which we believe to be the word of God, revealed to the Prophet Muhammad over a period of 23 years. So nothing static, but evolving, dynamic, responsive. The Sunnah or the Hadith literature, which is the words and deeds of the Prophet Muhammad, again, during his lifetime. I would, for purposes of human rights, point to you two more documents that are not as much talked about in human rights traditions in Islam. One is what is called the Medina Charter or the Medina Constitution. Now, the Medina Charter or the Medina Constitution is a set of agreements with the Prophet Muhammad conducted and concluded with Jewish and Muslim and non-Muslim communities of Medina when he migrated from Makkah and when he set up and established the first Muslim state. Surprisingly to a lot of people, the contents of those agreements, collectively called the Medina Charter, are very interesting for formulating human rights in Islam. For example, one article says, Ummah, so right now you and I, Ummah would say, oh, that means the Muslim community. No. The Ummah was defined as everyone who was a citizen of the city of Medina, Muslim or non-Muslim. So that actually gives you the sense of equality of all religions before a nation state. Secondly, that there was complete religious freedom and that the Jews could follow their religions and the Muslims could follow their religions, and the ones who had no religion were able to follow no religion. Now here, I think there has been a problem, because over the years, this document, under the influence of politics and due to the emergence of Muslim empire and imperialism in the world, this got dissipated. And inequality between Muslim and non-Muslim emerged. And I have to say that to this day, it continues. But the basis for evolving it remained. Secondly, there is the last farewell sermon of the Prophet. It's called the farewell sermon of the Prophet, which was a few not long period before he passed away. And in there, he talked against racism. He talked of religious freedom. He talked of equality before law and equal protection of the law for everyone, irrespective of whether he was a Muslim or non-Muslim. And he said in that sermon that if a Muslim were to do injustice to a non-Muslim, then because he was a Muslim, that shouldn't be a protection. That couldn't be an argument. Now, this kind of documentation seems to have really whittled away somewhere, or hidden away somewhere, or became invisible in the discourses of these 14 centuries. But here I have to say that what I'm talking about as human rights in the Islamic tradition is about the religious text. And I have to distinguish between Islamic perspectives and Muslim perspectives. So what Muslims do, and what Muslim states do, and what Muslim governments do is not necessarily a reflection of what is there in the religious text. However, one of the issues that we have in identifying Islamic conceptions of human rights is that there appears paradoxes and conflicts from within the religious text itself. So, let me go through a few examples there. Many years ago, I developed what you might call a categorization, like a flow chart, if you will, where I tried to divide rights as they appeared for me in the Quranic text. So there was a category of rights which you might call non-discrimination and equality for everybody. Then there was one which was protective, and another one of corrective. So correcting the issues of 7th century tribal Arabia, protecting the vulnerable and women and children, and finally making them all equal. But on top of that, in a corner perhaps, but sometimes completely overwhelming everything else, were 6 verses of the Quran that created hierarchies, that created inequalities between men and women, that created inequalities, whether it was evidence, whether it was inheritance, whether it was the male as the head of the household. And those 6 verses overtook the rest of the 6,000 verses in the Quran. Now here, why is it? The question that occurs to me, as somebody who's a student of Islam and human rights, why is it that 6,000 verses, you put them in the balance and they fall low, and 6 verses stand up and have more weight and are more developed over the centuries? And of course, the answer to that is that patriarchal, hierarchical, class-based societies of 7th century Arabia was the context in which these verses were revealed. And that along the centuries, it was mostly men who were in positions of power and authority. And no disrespect to any men in the room, men didn't one day go into the huddle and say, you know what, we have to actually interpret this to be against women. No, they did, they interpreted, they wrote, they sermonized according to their own context and their own experience. So if the man was the head of the household, then that's how he read the law. If it had been a woman who was head of the household, or if she had power and authority, maybe her context and her experiences might have come in. So let me give you an experience. The verses on polygamy in the Quran, and this is chapter 4, mind you, the whole chapter is called women, An-Nisa in Arabic. Okay? So chapter 4, verse 3 of the Quran is about polygamy. One of the most contested, which I say, one of the verses in the Quran that women's human rights perspective say that it creates inequality between men and women, and that it's discriminatory to women. So what does verse 4 say? Verse 4 says, this is the context where in the Battle of Uhud, there was a battle in which most able-bodied Muslim men fell. So you had a whole community where orphans and widows were left in the lurch. They were just left there. And again, in male-headed households, in patriarchal societies, what do you do to all these women and children? That is the context of verse 4, 3. In this it says, and it's a rough translation from the Arabic to the English, so please pardon me. It says, of these women and children, of these orphans, widows, you can marry 2, 3, or 4, provided you can deal justly with them. However, one is the best for you. And then it says in chapter 4, verse 129, so a few verses down, it says, it is impossible for you to do justice between women. Okay? So the combination of two, our dear men over the centuries, read through their own experiential lens and thought, of course I can be just. One house, one house. One car, one car. One diamond necklace, one diamond necklace. I'm just, I can marry. Okay? What about marrying the widows? I really shudder to think if we did a statistics of the whole world of Muslim men who were polygamous, how many of them had married old widows to protect them? Okay? So, in terms of an analysis, what I'm trying to suggest here is that the Quranic text is open to more than one interpretation, because in this day and age, you have Turkey and Tunisia who have banned, completely abolished polygamy on the same basis, on the same Quranic verses. Pakistan, Morocco, and a whole number of other countries have restricted this law and strangled it so that you have to prove your intention and the fact that you can be just and the fact that you go to court and you have to convince, all of that. But for me, what is very legitimate and driving force for me really is the fact that the great-granddaughter of the Prophet Muhammad insisted in her marriage contract that the husband be monogamous. Now, for me, why is it that in Islamic law, gender equality is not presented in the institution of marriage, which is a civil contract between two consenting individuals? Why? It's not presented to us as that. It's our elders. So the cultural dimension of Islam comes in, and it overpowers what the religious text gives us. If I told you, I don't even have a marriage contract because my grandfather was on behalf of my husband, and I think one of my cousins was on behalf of me. We had an oral marriage. And of course, it fell foul of the border authorities in the UK who said, don't be stupid, madam. How can you be married and not have a marriage contract? So I know firsthand how, when Islamic law was not applied properly, I had to suffer for it because they didn't believe that my husband was my husband and my daughter was my daughter because we did not have a written marriage contract. So that's for polygamy and the institution of marriage. Let's look at another thorny issue. And here is the death penalty. Now, what is mostly described as the only option in Islamic criminal law for a few, it's had penalty, which means the prescribed penalty, where, you know, where there are most serious offenses, then it is said that death is the penalty. However, death is not the only penalty. If you look at the Quranic verses, you will see very clearly that there are three options for any offender who has been convicted. Either the punishment is death, or the punishment is compensation to the heirs of the person he has killed, or it is forgiveness. Yeah? Now, if you read wearing your legal hat and your human rights hat, you will realize that there is ample scope in the Quranic verses that offer us something other than the death penalty also, because it is very clearly stated in the Quran. Why is it that it has been difficult to translate it into the law of Muslim countries? Has a lot to do with the sense of retribution and the sense of the way societies emerged. And we know from our experience of Europe, how long ago was it that some of these countries of Western Europe and others had the death penalty on the statute book? So it's to do with seeking alternatives. It's to do with looking at human rights through an evolutionary process of the religious texts. So for me, I would argue that insofar as the right to life is concerned, that there's so much premium put on it in the Quran, in the religious text, that it would not be completely impossible to actually bring in and insert other penalties than that of the death penalty. Particularly as Rabbi Jacobs was talking about witness, the evidentiary threshold of death penalty is so high that it is absolutely, I mean, it's next to impossible to actually prove. The fact that people are still hanged is not necessarily because of the Quranic verses standing on its own, but for a whole number of other social, political, lack of legal aid, and so on and so forth. Shall I now come to freedom of religion? Because this, again, is a very thorny issue and one that has rocked a lot of Muslim countries because freedom of religion and apostasy seems to be tied together. And supposedly, this is supposed to be built on the religious text. Now, if I can give you the English translation of two verses of the Quran. One says, to you, your religion, to me, mine. For those who know Arabic in the room, lakum deenukum waliyadeen. The second verse which I would like to refer to is, says, there is no compulsion in religion. Now, I've only mentioned two here. So, it means that religious freedom and forced conversion is something which you can argue that the Quran is not about. However, there are other parallel verses in the Quran where, in the name of trying to get more Muslims into the fold, there is the notion of defensive war. And if those people do not do not convert, do not accept the religious authority of the Muslim state, then there are consequences for them, and they are called dhimmi, which means these are non-Muslim citizens who have to pay what you might call a poll tax, the equivalent of a tax, of a religious tax. Now, my perspective on this is that these, if you read the context and if you read subsequent narrations and developments of the law, these are more political rather than religious edicts. Because if the Quran demands that there is no clergy between me and Allah, yeah? Sunni Islam does not have a clergy, by the way. So it's just me and directly talking to him or her. So if that is the case, and it is for my conscience only, whether I'm a Muslim, whether I'm a good Muslim, whether I'm a not so good Muslim, then if there are no intermediaries to give a stamp of approval to my religion and my religious beliefs, then surely, if so long as I not make it public, how will anybody be able to catch me and say, I'm going to hold on to you, you cannot leave Islam? The tradition that leads to restriction of religious freedom was not about religious freedom per se, but about treachery and rebellion against the new, small, fledgling Islamic community. That was the context where some people rose up and went against the state or the small state of Islam in Medina. So what I'm trying to say, and of course my view, as some of you will have realized by now, is not mainstream view. It is not what the majority of Muslims might believe. Why? And that is why I struggle with my research and I try to build upon the religious text in Islam, is so that I can convince my fellow religionists that whatever I'm talking about is not something secular, it is not something from outside the religious tradition. I am building each and every one of my argument from the religious text itself. And for me, the beauty of the religious text in Islam is its multiple and its plurality, its multiplicity of understanding, of definitions, of which way you can take that law. Because if Islam says that Islam is a religion for all times, and human beings, their honor, their dignity, their property are sacrosanct, then surely every age and every era must have a new take on the law. And that new take of the law will reflect the religious text, but it will be new. It will be contemporary. And most Muslim countries in the world have, I have to argue, they have started looking in this direction. Look at the example of slavery, and that's my final example. Slavery is definitely present as an institution in the Quranic text. It was practiced prior to Islam. It was practiced in early Islam. It is there. But my method of reading the verses of the Quran on slavery are that they have developed it in such a manner that it will gradually have to be ended. Now, why do I say that? The human rights tradition in Islam, if I was to use one example of the details of rights and obligations, it would be on slavery. Treatment of slaves, how do you treat them? How do you give them food? How do you give them the chance of liberty? The best work that a Muslim can do, if you want to expiate, you want to repent, is to free your slave. But the most explosive one, which gives me this belief that Islam wanted to get rid of slavery, the context was so powerful at the time that it could only subvert it slowly and hope that it would go away, which is what it had. Now, the example of that is the concept of mother of the free child. In the Arabic, it's Umm al-Walad. Mother of the free child. What does this mean? In the Quran, it is very clearly stated that if the master has a child from a slave woman, that child is his, has to be given paternity, is a legitimate child, will take the name just as the children of a free woman. But most interestingly, the woman cannot be enslaved again. So for me, these are moments in the religious text of Islam that you can actually build a building of human rights. It is not unproblematic. It is not uncontroversial. It is challenging. Why? Because I read the Quran through my eyes. Others read through their eyes. If I cannot say that the institution of polygamy is banned in Islam, of course not. I can't say it. I read it. It's very clearly there. But when I analyze the context and start making a law and tick box what the Quran is telling you should be in the law, then it is very difficult to continue polygamy. So what I'm saying is, I will end with this, to say that while on the one hand, there is inequality in some aspects of the human rights in Islam, but equally on the other hand, the Quranic text has built into that text an element of what I call positive subversion and a trend towards equality. I'll end with that, and thank you very much for your attention.
So thank you, Professor Ali, for a very powerful talk mapping the field of human rights and Islamic law and stating both the problems but also the potential solutions. I'm not saying the possible solutions, but at least the potential solutions that we have there. Now, allow me to pose a question to each of you before I open up the floor to the audience. Rabbi Jill Jacobs, so you are a rabbi in a Jewish community in the USA, and given your human rights work in Israel-Palestine, you might want to say something about how the Jewish community is failing the test of human rights, and maybe more importantly, what it would mean for the Jewish community to pass the test of human rights. And maybe Professor Ali, so thank you for breaking up this compatibility-incompatibility divide that unnecessarily traps us in this this frame of norm-conflicting rules. And instead, your focus was on gradualism, on basically how one could, or how Muslims can deal with early legal writings by phasing out certain legal options and preferring alternative readings, right? So phasing out of some options, a preference of others. And now to discuss with which options ought to be phased out, which should be strengthened, we would need a deliberative frame of Muslims jointly discussing and deciding on these questions. So where do you see Muslims failing, but also succeeding and pushing for like a more deliberation on this critical reading? And more so, how do they address institutions and procedures which are so needed for that kind of discussion? Please.
Thank you. I'll start by saying that the organization that I lead, TRUA, has an equal commitment, as I said, to working on human rights both in North America, in the US and Canada, and also in Israel and the occupied Palestinian territories. We try to work 50-50 in each area. And we do that because as rabbis and as members of the Jewish community who live in the U.S. and Canada, we have certain obligations toward the places where we live. And as Jews, we have an obligation toward the state of Israel, the Jewish state. And I'll say that the modern international human rights, of course, were very much, as probably you all know, were very much a response to the Holocaust. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights was published in 1948 and was very much an answer to the question of how the world can make sure that what happened to the Jewish people doesn't happen again. And Israel was, when Israel was created in 1948, it took as part of its Declaration of Independence a specific obligation toward the UN and toward following international law that came out of the UN, very much feeling the weight of both this history, which was not really history at the moment, it had just happened, and also feeling the possibility of international human rights bodies. And Israel has been a signatory on many, many human rights treaties over the years, one of the first signatories on the Refugee Treaty in 1951, et cetera. My organization works for the establishment of two states, of Israel and also a Palestinian state next to Israel, and is committed to the full human rights of both Israelis and Palestinians. And unfortunately, Israel is not currently fulfilling its international human rights obligations as pertain to the administration of occupied territories, including having Israeli citizens living in those occupied territories, and ultimately the Palestinians are not able to access the human rights that they should have by virtue of being human, including the right to a state, the right to be citizens of a state, freedom of movement, freedom from administrative detention, etc. And so Israel is not living up to those obligations. And I'd say that there are many Israelis who are working, as well as Palestinians, but I'll say many Israelis who are working in human rights organizations to try to push their own country to live up to that, to those standards, as well as Jews in the U.S. and including my own organization elsewhere in the world who are pushing for Israel to live up to those human rights obligations. And so I feel a lot of pain that Israel is not currently living up to those obligations, as well as the hope that the fact that many Jews, both in Israel and around the world, are pushing hard based on our own Jewish tradition, as well as based on the international human rights laws that were created in part to protect us, that there is hope for the future.
Thank you. I wish there was a simple answer to this very complex question of what about hopes, which way are we moving, and where can we actually take the alternatives in the Quranic text. Now, I'm an optimist forever and a day, which is what probably brought me here from a small mountain village in the northwest of Pakistan. But I can see the differences of using those alternative texts to advance human rights in the Muslim world. And I will give you two examples from Pakistan. The first one, I wasn't able to mention this, but in 1979, General Ziaul Haq, some of you may have read his name, he took it upon himself to Islamize the laws, whatever that meant. And part of these were a list of six hudud laws, serious laws, to which one of which was called the zina law, which means sexual intercourse outside of marriage, which is considered to be one of the most serious offenses in the Quran, and for which there is a very high, it's four adult Muslim male witnesses of the actual act. Yeah? And this obviously would have been next to impossible. In the entire 14 centuries of Muslim history, there has never been a single conviction because the evidence is so high. Now, what he did, of course, what he did was to water it down and to say that anybody could walk into a police station and could say, my wife or whoever, I've seen them engage in sexual relations outside of marriage, and this was non-bailable. It was offense against the state. The woman would be thrown into prison. The man would very nicely disappear. So the result of this was that thousands of women were languishing in prison, but because something was done in the name of Islam, I mean, I was saying to Rabbi Jacobs a while earlier that Israel and Pakistan have the distinctions of being two states in the world that have been made in the name of religion. And so any law that is made in the name of religion, you can bet your bottom dollar, it's going to be next to impossible to remove it from the statute books, because there will be a lot of hue and cry. In Pakistan, we struggled for 27 years. And finally, a law called the Women Protection Act was brought into the Parliament of Pakistan. And on the basis of Islamic evidence, it was declared that you cannot just ruin the reputation, the dignity, and the life of men and women by making frivolous statements. This is the most un-Islamic thing to do. Therefore, if somebody wants to go to the police station and make a complaint, they have to bring the four witnesses with them. A superior officer of the police has to investigate, and if everything adds up, then only you can write a report. The result is that there are zero cases since that day. So this gives me hope that the struggle from within the Muslim communities, from using the religious text, was helpful and was supportive. The second example is that of an oft-quoted hadith of the Prophet Muhammad, a misquoted hadith, which has multiple versions, which says that the Prophet is supposed to have said that whoever assigns their headship of a state to a woman is doomed. So it meant that no woman could ever become head of state. However, Islamic history is replete with women heads of state. But what happened was that in Pakistan, we've had Benazir Bhutto as head of state, we had other women standing, and this was undermined by the Quranic text itself, which says that there's a whole chapter called An-Niml, which is around the Queen of Sheba, and it's all about democraticness and competence and consultative government, and that the Queen of Sheba was such an excellent ruler. So of course the argument that activists made, and I wrote about it as well, small contribution, was that I argued on the basis of the Quran that this could not actually be sustainable, and therefore we could not have a law where Muslim women could not be head of state. So these are two examples. There are others not very happy examples where, you know, there is still a lot of intolerance. There is still a lot of politicization of religion, especially around the freedom of religion and apostasy topics. There are plenty of other debates, but at least this is a start where academic and hardcore research, I believe, can help us go in the right direction.
You both talked about the struggles making human rights become reality within both of your religious communities. So how much do you see it as a part of an argument, and how much do you see it as a part of a struggle to convince people? And if we talk about convincing, which people do you think have to be convinced?
I'll say first a word about Jewish law as it's the theory and the practice. And Jewish law, the system of halakha, which includes Jewish law, that's not necessarily a precise translation, developed over many centuries, of course. But for most of that time, Judaism, there was no place to actually practice civil law because Jews were almost always living under some other government. There were a few times in the medieval period where Jews had some autonomy within some other government around their own communal affairs. And even with the creation of the State of Israel, the State of Israel's law is based on British common law for historic reasons. It's not based on Jewish law, though there is some Jewish law that makes its way in here and there. And certainly around the creation, there was a flurry of activity of rabbis trying to figure out how to resurrect Jewish law having to do with civil issues that had never really been played out in practice, and how to apply it to a modern state. But that said, Israel runs according to British common law plus everything that's been added since the creation of the state. So there's the theory, so the something that is maybe a benefit is that when you are working in a theoretical system, your law can be as just as you want it to be. And so for many centuries, Jewish law, as an example, because I gave some example from criminal justice, there is really no system of prisons in classic Jewish law. And the rabbis didn't really have to figure out what to do with somebody who they couldn't kill because they had legislated capital punishment out of existence, but who maybe should get a punishment that was more than a monetary punishment. And when it came time in the medieval period, when Jewish communities actually had some ability to police their own communities, there was a lot of argument about whether there could be some kind of prison system instituted. In many cases, there was, because they were essentially copying it from the outside world. So there's some a lot of theory and less history of what was actually practiced, or less history of actually implementing it. And still, like I said, Israel doesn't run according to classic Jewish law. It runs according to British common law plus another 70 years of development. So in terms of, in terms of convincing, I think that it's important within the Jewish community. I know, of course, the U.S. Jewish community the best, but also in other Jewish communities, there are certain people for whom human rights is, it's clear that there's an obligation for human rights. It comes both out of what I spoke about, the idea of creation in the image of God, and also the obligation that comes from the history of the fact that international human rights law largely responded to our own tragedy. And so there are many, many people for whom who take that very seriously, and there are many people for whom Judaism is something that you do in synagogue, and it has to do with the ritual law, and it doesn't have anything to do with how we act in society. And I do think that it's important to assert that Jewish law is a whole system of how we are supposed to live in communities. It was never supposed to be only about ritual law. It's just that for most of our history, we only had control over our ritual law. We didn't have control over other parts of law. And so I do feel an obligation to persuade my own community that is just as important in our tradition as what you do and don't eat and what you do and don't do on Saturdays. In terms of successes, I'll just tell one story from my own organization. Like I said, we're 1,800 rabbis across the U.S. and Canada, which means we also represent hundreds of thousands of Jews. And over the last year, because of the current government in the United States, we've seen the silver lining is that we've seen many people who have not been engaged in human rights work or political work step up and take risks that they've never done. And so one example is that, as you probably know, one of the first acts of this administration was to try to implement a ban on people from certain Muslim countries entering the U.S., a ban on at least certain refugees, lowering the cap of how many refugees we're taking in. And for us in the Jewish community, we know from our history that the U.S. closed its borders essentially to Jews in 1924, and of course there are many people who might have fled from here, from Germany or from other areas that were controlled by the Nazis who could not come into the United States because the borders were closed. So we feel that very strongly. We understand either that we're alive today because our families were able to get in, or we know that many of our families either managed to survive and get into the United States after the war, or were not able to get in. And so we have that history. It's very strong, and we also have biblical history that the biblical laws that talk about treatment of the sojourner, somebody who's coming from somewhere else. So it goes from the very beginning through modern history. And so in February, right after, there have been a number of iterations of this, the administration trying to put this law into place and it being knocked down by the courts, and they come up with another version. So in one of those moments, they just come up with a new version. We organized 19 rabbis to get arrested in front of the Trump International Hotel in New York, in New York City. And for most of those rabbis, most of them had never been arrested before, but were willing to put their bodies on the line because of this understanding that our own history of being refugees many times in history, including from Nazi Germany, gives us certain obligations toward people who are refugees who are fleeing persecution now. And so that was a place where we just felt our history so strongly that people who never would have thought about getting arrested were willing to do it.
Thank you. I think from within the Islamic tradition and among Muslim communities and states, almost 56 odd Muslim countries in the world now, based on Muslim majority population. I believe that one of the basic problems has been talking over each other or at each other rather than talking to each other with dignity, with honor, with respect, with listening and trying to understand and hear the other party out. The Muslim world at this point is polarized. It's polarized to a point where on the one side you have people who argue that they are for democracy and liberals and human rights, and there are others who argue for religion, and they feel they want to bring an Islamic form of government, whatever that is. And so people on both sides are so polarized, and they're not talking to each other. So if I give you the example of Pakistan, for example, the so-called educated elite will pull their noses down on religious scholars. They will not engage with them. And the religious scholars will not engage with people who are educated or students of Islamic law, who perhaps the religious scholars think that they are modernized, westernized. Yeah? So there's this labeling. Now, I feel that is the biggest struggle and the biggest convincing that we have to actually do if among ourselves, and I blame myself and I blame hundreds and thousands and millions of Muslims like myself around the world who adopt a position of superiority, who say, you know, I know best and you have to listen to me, buddy. And the other buddy says, no, you have to listen to me. And so for me, I think, and I've experienced this. I mean, I remember at a conference many years ago talking about, just like I was talking to you now and reciting from the Quran, and I had this one gentleman literally hopping up and down in his seat, and he's saying, keep quiet, you don't know anything about it. And I'm saying it, and he's saying, you don't know anything about it. You see, because for him, it was too much of a, to absorb the shock of a woman who can read and understand the Quran and who's a lawyer as well and who has a voice as well. So I think this is the biggest struggle. So when you say, who do we convince? We convince ourselves, and we have to convince a lot of constituencies across the board. We have to have confidence in our own selves to be able to do this. And I think that because the Muslim communities, by and large, it's not simply that everybody lives by the Quran and the Sunnah. No, they're normal standard human beings who do good things and who do not so good things. And, you know, there is the Quran and the Sunnah, but in our day-to-day life, you don't carry the flag of, if you steal, you don't say, hey, I come with the Quran. Now, we have to understand, therefore, that the beginning point for me, I think, having been in government, got my hands dirty as well, almost died or not, I think it has to be from below, from non-controversial aspects of Islamic law. So the right to education, the first word in the revelation to the Prophet Muhammad was Iqra, read, educate yourself. Yeah? Now that is supposed to be non-controversial. Is it? Clean drinking water, health. Yes, these are supposed to be really non-controversial issues. Now, why is it a challenge for us? It's a challenge because for political elites, like if I'm this woman high-flying sitting here in Berlin talking to you, do I want the people in the village to be just like this? No, of course not. I want them to come and work for me. I want them to be under my thumb. So that is the problem. It's the politicization. We have to try and overcome that. But I think that the way I tried to convince, and I'll give you one example where it was touch and go. I was cabinet minister for health, as Naheed told me, in what was the Northwest Frontier Province, so where all the militancy has been, unfortunately, in the past in my own village. And I was also for population welfare, which means contraception. Yeah, the name for contraception, family planning. And this was an area where you needed to have tons and tons of children, if you wanted to, you know, and boys, of course. So we were having camps to facilitate women from all around the area to for hysterectomies, because those who wanted to. We didn't force them to. And because they were women who who just needed that surgery, we used to have camps. So I was told, look, you're doing this, and you're doing it in a very, very conservative, traditional area, and people are, you know, it's going to be quite dangerous. And because they said I had made a statement, a public statement in the full view of television and cameras, to say that Islam allowed contraception and population welfare. And I was told that I was doing the worst disservice to Islam, that I should be ashamed of myself. So now having a camp for women to have this operation so they could not have any more children, you can imagine what that could have been. So I said, never mind, I said to my colleagues, I said, I'm going to try. So I'm sitting here in an all-male audience, about 2,000 of them. And everybody came in their Sunday best. And of course, you know, they had to come to see the minister talking. And so everybody was coming very nicely. And very, very senior gentlemen and grandfathers and fathers. And so everybody was looking at me to think, you know, now what are you going to tell these people to convince them? And I started by saying, you know, I'm so pleased that we're here, and I'm so pleased that all of you are here, looking very healthy, looking very strong. And everybody's looking at me, oh, what is she doing? And I said, and I'm sure I said that in the Quran you will have read that when women, if women can and if they should, because it's a right of the woman to refuse to breastfeed, but if she should, then that will lead to strong boys and girls, and I emphasized boys, sons, and daughters, and it would lead to very strong families. And they couldn't see the point, so I soldiered on. So I said, and as a result of that, we know, I said, and I'm sorry that I'm saying this to you in public because you're all my elders here, but when a woman is breastfeeding, then, and God is saying at least for 18 to 24 months, that means that this child should have all the attention and all the breast milk of the mother and get all the nourishment. And that normally when a woman does this, then there is no second baby until she stops breastfeeding. Oh, yes, 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 everybody was saying. So I said, yes, but sometimes, you know, some women's bodies don't actually give this precaution. So they need a bit of help. And that help is contraception. So I muttered this under my breath, you know, like, yes, 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 and everybody was very happy. But because I appealed to what they could understand, rather than saying to them, you ignorant people, you don't know anything, it is modern to have one child, and you know, no, this just would not make any sense. And so you have to look at traditions. You have to look at people's ways of life, what they value. In my part of the world, they value a healthy son who will bring them lots of money, look after them in their old age. Yeah? So that is the point that I had to pick up and run with. So, and the mother has to be strong. The girls have to be given good food. Why? Because they can then produce those strong sons. So it wasn't rocket science, but I had to think it through in my head. And of course, it was dangerous because maybe they would have said, rubbish, off you go. But you have to put your stakes. I believe that you must be true to yourself. And if you really believe in the cause, then you have to stick your neck out. And you do succeed. At least I did. I'm alive here. Thank you.
I would like to know how the Orthodox rabbinate in Israel is justifying what is happening in the territories. Is there a law in the Torah or a saying that you can defend yourself? Or how are they seeing themselves under attack? Or how do they justify all of this with the regard to the law you just stated of humans are created in the image of God?
I have a question for you, Professor Ali. Two very short questions. One would be, you mentioned the importance of interpreting the sources in today's context. How do you counter the very common argument of the dead-end argument of bid'ah, for example?
Sorry?
Of bid'ah. Yeah. And the second question would be, you gave this example of the hudud law of in sexual intercourse outside of marriage and how you can actually improve the situation by going into the text deeper and enforcing this rule of four witnesses and so forth. My question would be, as someone or as a society thinking in a progressive way, how would you respond to someone, the situation being two people are caught in sexual intercourse outside of marriage and there actually are four witnesses witnessing the scene, but in any case, arguing for it being morally okay and not being restricted by law.
Do you want to start and then you close? Okay. Do you want to be? Yeah. Well, on an interpretation, basically, see, interpretation, we have to look at it as at some times becoming a double-edged sword. Yeah, it's a good thing if you can interpret and persuade your communities, well, ourselves and our communities, that this is the best way forward. And I use the word best in the way in which the Quran would use it, as the most just, as the one that would cause the least harm. Yeah, so it's a term of art. Now, on the one hand, there's that. Parallel to that is, of course, because in Sunni Islam there is no clergy, there's no intermediary, and each Muslim is entitled to and has the obligation to understand and interpret the Quran and act as they feel is the best. Okay? So here, when innovation, bid'ah, you said innovations come in, they've not always been pro-justice. For example, the innovation of the triple talaq, of the man, the husband in one breath saying divorce, divorce, divorce. And it's considered as a definitive divorce. Now that is obviously the most unjust thing that you can think about, but people are doing it. So in that question, in terms of your question, I think interpretation requires and the understanding and the knowledge that it has to be done with care, and it depends on which constituency you're actually looking to. On your second question of the hudud, when first you said how could one reorganize the law to be more just? Well, basically, if one reads the flow of the Quranic verses on sexual relations outside of marriage, they were not meant to, that was not the priority. The priority starts, the context starts of against defaming women and making accusations and allegations and spreading news about women's reputation. So in 7th century Arabia, a woman's reputation was really the most valuable thing in the world. So This was the Quranic verse. There was a group of Quranic verses which talked about an incident which happened with Aisha, one of the wives of the Prophet Muhammad, when they were coming back from battle, and she lost her necklace in the sand, and she was looking for it, and she by that time people had left, and one gentleman who looked back saw her and brought her back to the caravan, and because of that, tongues started wagging and people started saying all sorts of unsavory things. And the Quranic verse was saying, if one wants to go down the rumor mill and try to defame women, you must bring four witnesses of it. Otherwise, there's a counter offense, and that is qazf. When a person gives bad testimony or wrong testimony, then that person will be punished. So this was supposed to counter that. And after that came the verses about sexual fidelity, being faithful, being loyal to your husband and wife, and if you're not, and if this sort of a situation happens. So there's a lot that's gone beyond that, which I can't completely explain to you here, but it's a very progressive development of the husband and wife, marital fidelity, and so on and so forth. And there are different punishments or penalties if somebody's married or somebody's not. So it's to do with loyalty to your partners and so on and so forth. Your question about what do you see any law going in a or morality or whatever going where somebody can actually in a public place sleep with each other and have people looking at them? Well, that is, I think, private sense of you know, somebody's personal sense of what they consider to be appropriate and acceptable. I don't think that religion or laws or anything could actually say it going down that path. I mean, I think if we look at even the most liberal societies in the world, I doubt whether the sense of morality would say to people, you can come and go to bed in the middle of the town square and we'll all have a peep at you. So I'm not sure that I see that coming, at least not in my lifetime. I mean, I don't know, it might do, but do you see what I mean? I can't honestly say that it would go down that path in... Oh, sorry. Yeah, okay, please. Thank you.
So the question about how the Orthodox rabbinate justifies the situation in the occupied territories. I'll start by saying that actually the Orthodox rabbinate, this is not their primary concern. Their primary concern has to do with issues of marriage and divorce and education subsidies and a few other issues. So there have actually been the former chief Sephardic rabbi of Israel, Obadiah Yosef, for example, wrote a legal opinion that would have allowed for a two-state solution on the basis actually of saving, the possibility of saving life. So it's not actually primarily coming from the Orthodox rabbinate, though it is there. But the religious justification for the continued occupation has to do with the promise of the land of Israel that's given in the Torah, and the idea that God promises to Abraham and then on and on, that this will be the land that the Jews are given. And that the Jews coming out of Egypt and heading toward the Promised Land get to the land of Israel, which is not divided up according to where the green line is, where the 1967 armistice line is, or the 1948 line, rather. So it's based on that promise in the Torah, and it's also true that when we look at some of the areas that are in the territories, we have cities like Bethlehem, we have cities like Hebron that do have an incredibly important place in Jewish history, starting with the Torah. And I think, therefore, that it's important to be able to separate between the idea of the land of Israel as part of Jewish history and Jewish heritage and the political state of Israel. I actually think this is a mistake that the left often makes, that I won't say we, because I hope I don't do this, but often there's a sense of writing off that Jewish history, of saying, well, Hebron, in modern political terms, that is in the occupied West Bank, and forgetting the Jewish history. And I think instead that there's a way of saying, we believe that Eretz Yisrael, the land of Israel, within such and such boundaries, is part of Jewish history. And we also believe that in the current moment, it makes the most sense to have a political state, which can be different than an ancient heritage land, that it makes the most sense to have a political state that's based on negotiated boundaries that, God willing, will be negotiated. And to be able to maintain those two realities, which might mean that Jews will keep longing for the land of Israel just as we long for the land of Israel for the thousands of years that we didn't have political autonomy there. But it doesn't mean that we need to force a political state in those places. My fantasy would be that we have an agreement that would allow Jews to go and visit places like Hebron and Bethlehem, to go in and visit those places of our heritage, but I don't think that that means that they have to be contained within a political state of Israel. And I think it's important to be able to make that distinction, to acknowledge the religious heritage and also acknowledge the political moment that we're in and the hope, God willing, of creating a possibility that will allow for the human rights of both people.
Thank you so much to both of you for sharing with us the work you have carved out for yourself and for so many in the Muslim and Jewish communities, and hopefully more so, and offering perspectives for the very, exhausting day-to-day human rights work for many, maybe also in the audience, that we might be doing with religious communities. So thank you so much for these perspectives. And before thanking you properly, let me also announce the next event we have here on human rights, which is going to be on January 25th on human rights conventions and their receptions with Professor Galchinsky from Georgia State University in the US, Atlanta, and Professor Mashoud Badarin from the School of Oriental and African Studies in London. So it would be great to have you coming back on January 25th to continue this much needed conversation. Thank you very much.